Ledger on his way to his final resting place. But troubling questions about his death remain unanswered. Why did the woman who found his body call Mary Kate Olsen three times before dialing 911? And then Ricky Lake, from plus size to petite, how'd she do it? The mother of two lets us in on it. And her newest baby, plus Ringo Starr.
Liverpool, I left you, but I never let you down.
The former Beatles got a new hit song, everybody's talking about it. A command performance of Liverpool 8, all of it, in a studio concert, next on Larry King Live.
La, 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 la.
Before we do it, joining us to discuss a compelling documentary about home birth. It's revealing, too. Don't go away.
My midwife reminded me of all the reasons I went home and what I wanted to avoid and the gift I was giving my baby. And I was like, yes, you know, and I got through that that contraction. And you're one step closer.
Night, Dr. Sanjay.
President Bush's State of the Union, CNN Monday night, 8 Eastern.
Now, one of my favorite people, Ricky Lake, the actress and former talk show host. She starred in the original version, by the way, of the movie Hairspray. Her new documentary, we'll talk about that in a while, I'll show you some clips too, is The Business of Being Born. Well, what are your thoughts on Heath Ledger?
You're one of my favorites, by the way.
Oh, thank you.
Heath Ledger, I mean, I think I was a huge fan of his. I think they were a beautiful family. I think it's beyond tragic to lose someone at such a young age. I feel for the family. I feel like we should leave them alone in this time of grief.
How did you deal? Your own personal life has been in the public eye, weight issues, sexual abuse. How did you find the strength to get through that?
I mean, you know, I think we are implicated as public figures. You know, there's a line that we go to, and I think I've been incredibly candid, and I think that's partially why my talk show was successful and ran for as long as it did. But I think, you know, there's a line, like in a situation like this, where we should not be so interested in seeing pictures of Michelle Williams with her baby. I mean, I don't want to watch all that, but yet we buy the magazine covers. I mean, I'm the one that gets the subscription in the mail, so I think we're all implicated, but I want to also put myself in their shoes and think, gosh, it's incredibly
But Ricky,
incredibly
you could
private.
Have become a Lindsay Lohan or a Britney Spears, right?
I guess I could have. I
On
was
the way
young.
To the same kind of story.
I mean, I was 18 when I got famous. Hairspray was my first movie. I mean, I guess I could have, but I think I had, I don't know, I wanted a future. I wanted to do something beyond my first film, and I didn't partake in all that partying. I was a very young 18 also. I was, you know, very late in exploring and meeting guys and stuff like that. I was on the young side.
Let's discuss the weight. Were you always overweight?
I was overweight probably in my late, I'd say like my 9 years old, 10 years old is when I started to gain weight. And I think I attribute it to the sexual abuse that I had that happened to me at an earlier age, at 6 or 7.
Where did you grow up?
In Westchester County.
New York?
Yes. Normal, two-family upbringing, had a sister.
How'd you lose the weight?
I lost the weight just by diet and exercise. In my early 20s, I lost over 100 pounds. So it seems like this is something that's been a part of my life and in the public eye for a long time, I mean, 2 decades. So I was 200 pounds when I did Hairspray. I was 260 pounds when I did China Beach. So in that time frame, 200 pounds was cute for me. 260 wasn't cute anymore, and I couldn't get jobs. And so I felt like, I think I got that this business is all about having a gimmick and having something different about you. And by changing my physicality, that was the one thing I could control. And I starved myself, and I lost over 100 pounds. And then this time around, I started February 2nd, and I had this documentary that I'd made and been working on for 3 years, and it was about to premiere at Tribeca Film Festival last April. And I had 9 weeks to get myself in great shape. I wanted to reinvent myself and show myself in a new light. And I lost 35 pounds in 9 weeks by really going on a major, like you know, strict food plan and working out. And it was fast. I mean, it felt like there was a connection between what I was trying to say in this film about, you know, learning to love my body and having my baby on my own terms. It's all like a connection, and I felt like I was in some ways purging, and I think it was healing for me. I can't really explain why this time around I lost the last of the weight, but it's been almost a year, and I've kept it off.
Nervous about getting it back?
I think if something tragic happens, I mean, I think I'm an emotional eater just like everybody else. And I think, you know, people are noticing now. I can't say never, but I hope not. I mean, it's been a work. It's work. I work out consistently.
Do you have desires every day?
Yeah. Yeah. You didn't have anything in the green room at all. I was looking. Yeah, I like chocolate. I like, you know. But it's all in moderation. I think it's being consistent. I think it's being conscious of what you put in your body. You know, there's no magic pill. There's no secret. It's hard work and being consistent. And it's paid off. I mean, it's amazing how that got me on the cover of magazines. And for me, I had an agenda. I wanted to get the word out about this movie.
You were fat when you were doing the talk show, weren't you?
I what? Well, I was fat. I mean, I think I had in the closet, I had anywhere from a size 6 to a size 20. And we had, you know, depending, because I got pregnant during two years of the show. So I would go up and I would go down, and everyone saw it. Everyone saw the bad hair days, and, you know, but I guess it's part of the job, you know?
We have an email question from Anna in Worcester, Massachusetts. Hi, Ricky. What advice would you give a 38-year-old woman who can't seem to lose any weight, no matter how hard she tries? By the way, you look fabulous, she adds.
Oh, thank you. I mean, I don't really think I have the secret. I mean, I think it's any diet works. I've done them all. Jenny Craig works. If you stick to it, they all work. But it's just you have to eat that food or stick to that plan. Weight Watchers is a great program that all of my friends have been successful with. For me, you know, I did this organic food program where I had food delivered. It was 1,200 calories. And then I would up my calories if I worked out. But I was just conscious and aware of what I put in my body and how I took care of it.
You said earlier you thought the sexual abuse led to overeating.
I think so. I mean,
what's the relation?
Well, I think for me, and I've been in therapy for a long period of time, and even during the course of my talk show, my executive producer wanted me to go to therapy because he felt it would make me a better host, to be more in touch with what was going on with me. I think the weight, it was a protective barrier for me. I wanted to keep myself attractive, unattractive to men. You know, food was a comfort for me. I mean, I think I equate it to that, but maybe there's other issues as well. I was probably predisposed. I think it probably ran in my family. But it's something that I've kept off, and it's great that, I mean, I'm glad that I'm an example of someone who can do it and keep it off, because honestly, if I can lose the weight, anybody can.
Have you ever confronted your abuser?
No, I think he's dead. I wouldn't say I confront. I was a very little girl. I was 7. And I remember, I mean, I have visuals of just that moment where I finally told my parents and they confronted him. And I have, like, you know, I peeked over the bench as they confronted him. But this was a long time ago, and this is before McMartin, you know. And so it was not talked about. We just kind of, it
How
happened.
Do you feel about it? You hate him?
You know, I have sort of no feelings about it. I mean, I wish it didn't happen to me. And I have to say, it didn't affect me as much until my children, my sons, were the age I was. The idea of them being violated in the way that I was at that age, that's what makes me crazy, you know? But I'm very vigilant about them. I'm a little borderline paranoid. I don't want them ever, you know, going off with some strange, you know, like coach or something. You know, it's like I'm very protective of them. And I think we know a lot more now. I don't think my parents did anything. You know, it's like that was the time when we were free to do whatever we wanted and riding big wheels all day, you know?
Tell me about the documentary.
The documentary is called The Business of Being Born. It's basically, it's more me than anything else. You know, I did my talk show for 11 years, and I think this was something I wanted to do. I wanted to do something that was pro-woman.
What do you mean by the business of being born?
Well, it's very much a business. If you look at the money that we spend per birth in this country, you know, there are decisions being made about women and C-section rates and, you know, for fear of malpractice, for reasons that are other than being in the best interest of mother and baby.
What do we see in the documentary?
Well, that's me in labor. That's me probably an hour before I gave birth. It's not the prettiest picture of me, but I think there's images of birth in this film, not only mine, but other women.
Births.
Yes, we show my birth, my birth of my second son in my bathtub. It's a very small part of the film, but I think these images of women giving birth on their own terms is so important for women to see. You know, we look at birth and we fear it, and we think that it's something that we need to be saved from, or it's an emergency, a potential emergency, and really it's very natural. And I think in the technology that's been created with women being able to carry children at 50 years of age, or premature babies are able to live at early and earlier gestation, I think it's amazing. Great strides have been made. But I think we've lost natural birth in the process. And so this message is about women getting empowered and educated when it comes to birth.
Why a bathtub?
I had done a lot of research about water. And Michel Odant, who's in the film, he's a doctor from France. I'd studied, I'd done all the research, and I felt like that was the safest place for me and for my baby. And I have to say, for me, physically, it was so gentle on my body, and for my baby, which you see in the film, he was alert, he was clean, there was nothing gross. I had a midwife. And so this, I'm very pro-midwifery. I think midwives are underrated, they are undervalued. And
is this your second baby?
This is my second baby. I had a midwife with my first as well.
So what was the big difference in water and not in water?
Well, I was in the hospital. The first one was in a hospital setting.
Standard birth.
Pretty typical. I mean, especially if you look at like what happens today, a lot of births are given intervention to move you along because they need that bed filled with other women. You know, they don't want you to labor on your own for as long as it takes.
What was the big difference between the tub?
I think the respect that was given to me at home. I mean, I remember giving birth, you know, in the movie you see that I pull my baby out. She says, reach down and pull out your baby. And I do. And he's skin to skin. He's completely alert. There was no drugs, no intervention. I got into my bed, he was in my arms for a couple of hours, and then at a certain point, my midwife asked permission to take the baby and weigh him and check him over. And I felt like the respect that was given to me to ask permission, as opposed to in a hospital where you as a mom have to ask permission to see your baby, you know?
The documentary is The Business of Being Born. It's being shown right now.
It is, and it's coming out on Netflix next month.
And we'll be right back with more of Ricky Lake and then Ringo Starr. Don't go away.
I understand that you do an amazing dance to get women. Ooh. Do you want to see it, ladies? What did that do for you?
Not a day going through it.
Trusted name in news.
You should be on that council, not her.
I know I should, Penny. Hey, I'm going to the hop tonight.
Oh, let me come. We'll lie and say we're going to the library to study.
It's a deal.
What do you think when you see yourself like that?
I love it. I love it. It was such a great summer. I made that movie with John Waters and Divine, and I didn't even know who they were. It was just like being plucked out of nowhere, not unlike Nikki Blonsky, who kind of was working in an ice cream parlor and got famous. It was the same kind of thing, and I look back at it, and I think I'm so grateful that John Waters picked me for whatever reason, and he's still a dear friend. He just texted me because we have an article in Newsweek on the documentary. He was like, I'm proud. Like, he's so proud. So
What did you think of the new Hairspray?
I loved it. I mean, I think I'm far enough away from it. It's 20 years ago that I made that movie, and I think I'm really glad I'm doing the things that I'm doing with my life.
Did you ever think Travolta would play the part you played?
No, Divine. He played Divine's part. Mother, Nikki Blonsky played my part. That would have been a really interesting choice if he played Tracy. I thought he was great. I mean, I'm glad they went a totally different direction from Divine. I think I'm so partial to the original and a little protective of it. But I thought they did a great job, and I had a cameo in it, and I sang on the soundtrack, and I was really glad to be a part of it.
And we also remember Serial Mom.
Yes.
That was a fun movie.
That was a favorite of yours, right? It was great. Kathleen Turner and Sam Waterston, and it was a really... Every John Waters movie is so unique because it becomes like a family. Cry Baby with Johnny Depp. I played Johnny Depp's sister. And you live with these people for 4 months. They become your family, and it's like an experience that stays with you forever.
Don't you act anymore?
I do. I did a Lifetime movie for breast cancer this year, and I did a feature called Park. I mean, I've made a commitment when I had kids that I didn't want to do anything to uproot them or leave them for a long period of time. But I'm certainly looking to continue to do more acting. I feel like now that I'm kind of reinventing myself and showing myself a different way, I'm about to be 40 at the end of the year. Hopefully there's opportunities out there for me now.
Are the kids close with their father?
Very. He was here. You know, the minute Ringo Starr, I heard he was here, I called up, you gotta bring him over. So we're big Beatles fans.
Right?
I am divorced, but
friends.
We're very, very good friends. I mean, I think we co-parent. I think we're an example of a positive divorce. You know, it's not ideal, it's not what we plan to do, but it really works out.
Are you dating?
I'm dating, but there's nothing to tell.
Nothing jumping out.
If you know anybody, I'm looking.
Back with more moments with Ricky Lake. The documentary is The Business of Being Born. Don't go away. We're with Ricky Lake. Let's tie up some loose ends. What, in essence, are you saying about birth in America?
I think birth in America is in crisis. If you look at the numbers, if you look at the fact that we have the second worst infant mortality rate in the developed world, and the maternal death rate in this country is on the rise, and yet C-sections, women, one in three women are getting a C-section here in this country. We need to look at this and realize that there's something wrong, inherently wrong in the system. And I'm not anti-hospital, I'm not anti-doctor, I'm just, the system is not working.
C-section is wrong?
C-section is necessary when necessary. I think that so many women are being told that that's safer for them, it's, you know, safer for the baby. Yes, in some instances, high-risk situation with twins, with breech. Yes, I'm not anti-C-section, but I think a lot of women are being told that an elective C-section is the way to go. And I think with malpractice, you know, being what it is, and this litigious society that we live in, that everybody wants a perfect baby. And when the perfect baby doesn't happen, we want someone to blame. And I think these doctors, their hands are tied. Their malpractice insurance is through the roof. They need to do a certain number of births. I mean, I get it. I get it that everyone is struggling. Obstetricians are not wanting to deliver babies anymore because they don't want to take the risk.
They get a lot of malpractices.
Absolutely. And I think midwives, you know, are really, I want to shed some light and change the stereotypes and hopefully, you know, give them an opportunity to work more integrating in the system with doctors.
When someone has been abused, at no matter what age, do you think about it a lot?
Well, do I think about when others are abused?
Yeah,
I
mean, when you read in the paper of it, when you...
Yeah, I think, I mean, I think I'm a compassionate person. I think part of that's why I really enjoy doing my show. I care about people. I care especially about the everyday person. You know, I'm not interested in, like, you doing celebrities. It's not, that wasn't my forte. I much prefer talking to real people about real issues. But certainly I think things affect me. And I'm a mother, so certain, there's the environment. I mean, big issues, you know, politically where we are. I mean, I'm very concerned. And I think I want to do my part.
Do you ever wonder about the abuser? Why he is an abuser?
Yeah, I think a lot of times, you know, they lack a father in their lives. I mean, I think, you know, you can look at, I don't know a lot about this, and I'm not an expert. I mean, birth is more my... No, I didn't. I mean, I know my own history and what happened to me. I don't think, I mean, in talking about it in my 20s and coming out with that, I realized I was not alone. I mean, you look at, I think one in four women or one in three women have been abused in some way during their lifetime, and men too, it happens. I mean, I think, It's nice to be more conscious of it today than we were back when I was abused.
Miss the talk show?
No, no. I don't. I don't.
How many years you do it?
I did it for 11 years. I did over 2,000 shows. I loved every minute of it. I loved that platform. I loved that I got to be heard. I was 23 years old, and they were listening to me about what I had to say about whatever issue. But I think in this way, I loved making this film. I believe it's my sort of message, and I prefer that.
It was Garth Ancier's baby, right?
Yes, yes, it was his concept. He picked me. He definitely gets the credit for picking me.
Why did it go off?
I think my contract was up, for one. I wanted to leave New York. I love New York, and I'm a New Yorker at heart, but I think I wanted to move my family out west and try something new. And, you know, the talk show, syndication is not what it was. And I think it ran its course. It was amazingly successful. It went off the air with really very, very respectable ratings. I'm also glad to phase into something else.
So you wouldn't want to go try it again?
I wouldn't say I would never want to. I mean, never say never. And every year someone pops up and wants to do a talk show with me again. I think I'm good at it. Like, there's a knack. And obviously you're pretty good at it, too. But I think... I think that might be an opportunity down the road, and I think for now I want to continue making pro-social films.
Do you get lots of offers?
I do. I mean, I don't want to be patting myself on the back. It's not like my phone's ringing off the hook, but I think this is an exciting time in my career. It's certainly the most exciting I think I remember.
Somebody told me to ask you about your relationship with singer John Mayer.
There is no relationship. I met him, and he was really cute. That's it.
How did that start?
I met him at a party. It's amazing. The media kind of gets in, like they see you somewhere. Literally, I am more intimate with you right now than I was with him. Exactly. Now we'll be an item. So tell your wife. I just shook your hand.
You met him and you liked him?
Well, whatever. I mean, I liked meeting him. Just like I like meeting a lot of people. But and he
but
liked me, so that was it. I think, yeah, they it became like a news item, and then people picked up on it, and I guess a lot of people follow his romantic life. I've never, ever, ever been involved with a famous person, ever in my life.
We got about a minute. What do you think of Britney Spears?
I think it's incredibly sad. I mean, she was on my show in her first couple times, but with her first single, I remember she was like 16 years old. I think I did Regis and Kelly once with her, Regis and Kathy Lee. And I think of those children. You know, really, when I look at her, I really feel for those little boys, and I hope she can rise to the occasion to be the mother that she needs to be.
You think she can straighten it out?
I don't know, but I feel like we, the media, you know, following every move of hers does not help the situation. I don't know what the answer is. I mean, I don't know. I thank goodness I don't have that kind of attention on me.
Thanks, Ricky.
Thank you. It's a pleasure.
Wonderful.
Thank you so much.
Ricky Lake, the actress, former TV talk show host, and the star of a new documentary, The Business of Being Born. Ricky Lake, always good to see her.
Say goodbye.